فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
And no one is above advice and no one is above admonishment, صح؟ Everyone can be advised and everybody can be told what is wrong with him. So there is nobody who has any rights to say what? Ah, me. You are telling me. This is not how our religion works. This is not how it works. Also, the other benefit that we take from it is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he told, the fourth one is, when you tell a person that you're wrong, you always tell them why or where they went wrong. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, da'ahu, leave him. He didn't just leave it there. He said, فَإِنَّ الْحَيَاءَ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. For verily, what you're advising him against is actually a branch from the branches of an iman. And you explain to the person where you think they went wrong. So they have understanding. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ taught. Because we don't want the people to become blind followers. Whenever they're told to do something, they just do it because they were told to do it. Naam.
Chapter, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah At-Tawbah. But if they repent and accept Islamic monotheism and perform as-salat and give the zakat, then leave their way free. Narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I have been ordered by Allah to fight against the people till they testify that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the messenger of Allah, and to perform as-salat and to give the zakat. So if they perform all of that, then they save their lives and properties from me, except for Islamic laws, and their reckoning will be with Allah.
باب فإن تابوا وأقاموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة فخلوا سبيلهم.
الإمام البخاري chapter here آية from the Quran, the fifth آية in سورة التوبة. الله سبحانه وتعالى says فإن تابوا, if they repent. Repent from what? Min ash-shirk wal kufri. If they repent from disbelief and polytheism and they come to Islam, but then look, the repentance, it's not unrestricted. It is tawbatun mashruta. It's a tawbah, conditional tawbah. There's something that has to come with it. It can't just be mujarrad atubu ila Allah wa astaghfirullah. La. Allah says fa in tabu, if they repent. Wa aqamu as-salat. This wawul atf shows that this is with it. It has to come with it. Which is what? They establish the prayer. وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ, and they give the zakat. فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ means أي لا تَقْتُلُوهُمْ. Don't fight with them. And don't go in war with them. Meaning now they've become your brothers. There's no need for you guys to ever have a fight again. So here this hadith shows us that after the person repents, if he doesn't come with the prayer, and if he doesn't come with the zakat, that person hasn't fully, is the repentance going to be accepted from them? Because the hadith has a what? It has a mantuq, and it also has a mafhum. The mantuq of the hadith is, of course, what it says, that if he repents, comes with the prayer, gives the zakat, then leave them alone and don't fight with them. There's no need to fight anymore. They're your brothers, right? What about if they don't pray? And what about if they don't pay zakat? It means they haven't repented and their repentance is not accepted. So what does that show you? That the person who leaves the prayer is what? He's kafir mushrik. That's why the evidence of the scholars used to show that anyone who leaves the prayer is a disbeliever is this ayah. فَإِن تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُمْ. This is also a refutation on who? عَلَى الْمُرْجِئَ, the deviated group, who said what? أَنَّ الْإِيمَانَ لَا يَحْتَاجُ إِلَىٰ عَمَلٍ, that the iman does not require action. This is a refutation on them. How is it a refutation on them? Because look, أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ is actually added to their belief. So for them to have iman, they would have to come with salah and zakat. Are you with me? Without it, there's no religion that's going to be accepted from them. The Prophet then, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, naam.
حدثنا عبد الله بن محمد محمد المسندي قال حدثنا أبو روح الحرمي بن عمارة قال حدثنا شعبة عن واخر بن محمد قال سمعت أبي يحدث عن ابن عمر أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أمرت أن أقاتل.
أمرت, when the Prophet says that, he means أمرني ربي, my Lord commanded me. When the Sahabas say umirtu, oh umirna, oh nuhitu, oh nuhina, if the Sahabas they say that, they mean who is the one who's commanding them? فَمَنِ الْآمِرِ Who is the nahi, the one that prohibited them? They mean the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So when the companions say umirtu, and when they say umirna, or say nuhitu, or nuhina, they mean the Prophet. But when the Prophet says that, what does he mean? Allah. Does that make sense? And this is what the qawl of Ibn Salah rahimahullah he took. And this is also the qawl Zainuddin al-Iraqi he took in his Alfiyah. And this is the qawl Ibn Kathir took in his al-Ikhtisar fi ulum al-Hadith. And Ahmed Shakir accepted it and agreed with him on al-Ba'ith al-Hathith. Ibn Hajar also mentions that as well in his Nukhbat al-Fikr. On the sharah of Nuzhat al-Nadhar fi tawdih Nukhbat al-Fikr. Naam.
أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى.
What the Prophet means by أمرت أن أقاتل الناس, I was commanded to fight with the people. A, if I call them to the religion and they don't accept, then I fight with them. That's what it means.
أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يشهدوا أن لا إله إلا الله.
But then, if they say لا إله إلا الله, حتى هي is للغاية. Until they say la ilaha illallah, that's when I leave them alone.
وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ,
and that I am a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ,
and they established a prayer. ما معنى يُقِيمُ؟ يُقِيمُ means وَيُصَلُّونَ وَيُحَافِظُونَ, they protect its arkan, its wajibat, its shuroot, they protect all of that. Then I will. So it's not just mujarrad, just throwing yourself on the floor. It means you come with the arkan. You come with the prerequisite, the shurut. You come with the wajibat. Naam.
وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةِ,
and they give the zakat al-mafruḍa, the zakat that's obligatory on them. Naam. When it reaches the nisab, it reaches the amount. وَحَالَ عَلَيْهِ الْحَوْلِ, the yearly cycle goes by. And there is no mani', no prevention on his side that's preventing him, like debt. Because if there's debt on your neck, then you don't have to pay your zakat. None of that is in place. So the shart is there, the sabab is there, the mani', intafa al-mani'u, the prevention is also absent. Then it becomes wajib for you to pay the zakat. You have to pay the zakat. Naam.
فَإِذَا فَعَلُوا ذَلِكَ,
ذَلِكَ, فَإِذَا فَعَلُوا, if they do, ذَلِكَ الْمُشَارُ إِلَيْهِ, that which has just been mentioned, which is what? Shahidu shahadatayni, they testify to the two testimonies. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Wasallu, and they pray. Wa addu zakata, and they fulfill the zakat, and they do that. What happens?
Asamu minni dima'ahum.
Asamu means a muni'u. I'm prevented and I am stopped from their blood. Yeah.
Wa amwalahum,
and their wealth. I don't spill their blood, nor do I take their wealth.
إلا بحق الإسلام,
unless they go close to an Islamic reason to kill them. For example, they kill another person. صح؟
وحسابهم على الله,
and their accountability is with Allah. What does that mean, their accountability with Allah? If they falsely pray, and they falsely say the shahadatain, and they falsely pay the zakat just to look like the Muslims from the outer, that's not our business. We're just going to judge them from the apparent. What's in their heart is between them and Allah. وَحِسَابُهُمْ, that which is inside their heart is with Allah. Our job is not to check people's hearts and, wallah, he just took Islam, let's give him a 3 months probation period. We have to check him. We have to sneak into his house and find out what he's doing. That's none of our business. If he takes Islam from that minute, he's our brother, we trust him, we live with him. وَحِسَابُهُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. نعم.
Chapter. Whoever says that
so faith. This hadith, there's many benefits that we take from it. Number one, we took the qawl of fa'in tabu, if they repent, benefits from the ayah, what it means, fa'in tabu. We also learn in the second hadith is what? Manzilatul salah, the status of the prayer, and the status of zakat in Islam. And also, of course, before them too, the status of shahadatayni, shahadatu an la ilaha illallah, wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Also, this hadith is the hadith that scholars used. بعض العلماء, some scholars of hadith, they used على من ترك الصلاة, anyone who leaves off the prayer, deliberately he's killed. And even then, there's still a discussion amongst the scholars. Number four. This hadith shows us that repentance is accepted even from a kuffar. That repentance is accepted from the kafir. And there's no action worse than kufr a person can come with. Even then, it's accepted from them. فَإِن تَابُوا وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ If they repent and they pray, Allah is going to accept it from them. Even though they said statements which were disbelief and bad things, then if a person repents from smaller than kufr, we should accept it from them. We should what? We should accept it from them. Naam. Number five. The ahkam, the rulings and the regulations are based on the apparent. Al-ahkam tubna ala al-zahir. The ahkam are based upon the apparent. Amma bawatinahum, as for the internally what's in them, fa'amruhum mawkulun ila Allah. We leave that with Allah. And we leave Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to deal with them. Also, this hadith is amun makhsus. It's amun makhsus. Which is, some people now may, you know, what's it called? Dispatches. Do you guys know dispatches? No? Record people like that. Bring on BBC News, huh? So now I'm going to explain all about it, which I said right now. So hear it properly. It's amun makhsus. It's general, but it's intended specification in it, which is adillatul jizya stands. So they're not killed. Say shahadu la ilaha, not killed. No, it's not like that. They're given jizya to pay, which is an additional external evidences that are used. Does that make sense? The adillah that the Prophet says, command them, hatta yu'tul jizyata an yadin wa hum saghirun, is taken from them. They pay tax. And that tax brings them the rights to be protected. No one's allowed to kill them. No one's allowed to get close to them. They don't have to leave their religion. They can carry on believing what they believe. They pay that jizya and the government makes sure that they're looked after. Sah. And they become citizens of the people of that land. Sah. Naam. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَلَا بِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَلَا يُحَرِّمُونَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ورسوله ولا يدينون دين الحق من الذين أوتوا الكتاب حتى يعطوا الجزية عيد وهم صاغرون. Number seven, the seventh benefit that we take from this hadith is what? That the blood of a believer is haram from you. Spilling a blood of a believer, the day of judgment when you come in front of Allah, you should know what you're going to say. Youngsters were killing each other on drugs. لزوال الدنيا أهون عند الله من قتل امرؤ مسلم. The Kaaba to be destroyed is more or less important to Allah than the blood of a believer. This whole world to perish, this whole world to go, in the eyes of Allah is less than one blood of a believer to spill. Today if we told the people the Kaaba has been destroyed, there's an enemy coming, they want to destroy the Kaaba, everybody would say, where? I need to go, I need to defend the Kaaba, right? But if a believer's blood is spilt, no one feels it, no one feels the pain. The Prophet looked at the Kaaba and he said, مَا عَظَمَكْ وَمَا أَشَرَفَكْ What's greater than you? What is more honorable than you? إِلَّا دَمُ مُرُؤُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ Except the blood of a believer. The blood of a believer is more honorable than you, O Kaaba. صح? Islam gave a lot of importance. If the person can come the day of judgment, فِي فُصْحَةٍ مِّن دِينِهِ مِّن دَمٍ حَرَامٍ Far from the blood of a believer, then come the day of judgment, wallahi. You will be questioned the day of judgment. The person will say to Sil, ask him, oh Allah, lima qatalini, why did he kill me? And now you see internet, you look at these little people are killing each other, youngsters in this country. It's just insignificant. The other day in London, West London, a boy got killed. He's only 19 years old. 19, brothers. 19. Because the Somalian youngsters over there in West London are on drugs. They're selling drugs. They got into a street rage and street battle with the Jamaicans, and it became World War III. And now what? They're killing each other. He's 19. Look at his life. He's just started. Just started his life, and he's dying on the streets. For what? for the powder, for the drugs. Your blood, Allah gave it so much importance. Look how it became hadar. No one's going to probably be caught for that. No one's going to be known who did that to you. You died. The parents who brought you to this country were probably running away from guns from back home. It would have been better, at least you got shot in your country, in a Muslim country. Ah. So it's a problem, wallahi, it's a problem wherever you look. It's a problem wherever you look. Islam has given very important rule issues. وَمَنْ يَقْتُ الْمُؤْمِنَ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِّبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَعَدَّلَهُ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا, right? Anyone who kills a believer, five things have been promised for him. Five things. وَمَنْ يَقْتُ الْمُؤْمِنَ الْمُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِّبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَعَدَّلَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. Five things that no other sin has been said like this. No other sin. Anybody who kills a believer deliberately, what is it that he's going to get? وَمَنْ يَقْتُ الْمُؤْمِنَ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ. His abode, his final ending is Jahannam. خَالِدًا فِيهَا is going to stay there forever. خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah becomes angry with him. وَلَعَنَهُ. Allah cursed him. لَعَنْ is what? أَطَرْضُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah distance you from his mercy. He has no mercy for you. And last but not least, the punishment of the hellfire for you is severe. It's what? It's severe. Same in Canada. A lot of youngsters, a lot of youths are dying every day. The statistics of those who are dying in one area, one block. It's disgusting, brothers. I went there. It's disgusting. Drugs. Darahima ma'duda. Pennies. Big guys are making the real money. They're making the real money. You're running around like a headless chicken. Trying to leftover changes. Your life is gone. You guys probably know more worse stories than I do. But it's sad. Sahih? Is it like that even here in Leicester? It's very bad, huh? Huh? Don't worry, if I do look at you, it doesn't mean you're the one who sells drugs or used to sell drugs. It's just a general, okay? Some brothers start looking sideways. Yeah? It's like, it's bad here, huh? It's bad, yeah? It's not that bad? Allahu Akbar, alhamdulillah. Hey, fadal. If we do 29, are you with me? At least we've done half. At least we've done half. So if we take it to Babu, Kufranul Ashiri wa Kufrin duna Kufrin. If we do that, that would be good. At least we did half of Kitab al-Iman. Half. We came here to do everything. But we'll finish, inshallah ta'ala. If you guys all ready, we can go to Fajr. See you guys. Sabar today, eh?
Chapter, whoever says that faith is actions. Imam Bukhari said, referring to the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is the paradise which you have been made to inherit because of your deeds which you used to do. A number of religious learned men explained the verse, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so by your Lord, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we shall certainly call all of them to account for all that they used to do. And the statement, La ilaha illallah, that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah. And Allah said, for the like of this, let the workers work.
Babu, man qala innal iman huwa al-amal.
Imam al-Bukhari here, he's talking about the issue of what? That the actions are what? Man qala, those who said innal imana huwa al-amalu, those who said that the iman, somebody might think to himself, like, does he not believe that? Why is he saying those who said? Sah? If Bukhari says those who said that the actions part of iman, does it means that he's pushing away from himself and he's attributed to a group, right? When this is actually a consensus, we said there's no khilaf amongst Ahlul Sunnah. So why is he attributing it to it? And it looks like there's no consensus in the issue. How do we mention it? There's kalima mahdufa. Scholars bring two kalimat are mahdufa. One, and these are the two ihtimalat, that he means babu tashihu man qala inna al-iman huwa al-amal. Babu chapter, authenticating and agreeing with the ones who said that the iman is actions. That's one view. Bring the word tashih. The second view is to say ad-dalilu liman qala inna al-iman huwa al-amal. The second word, which is mahduf, that they say is the evidence of the one who says that the iman is what? It's actions. And then he brings the qawluhu ta'ala, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ is a بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ, that which he used to believe. And that's why Bukhari rahimahullah used it here. بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ, it means بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ. So if it becomes تَعْمَلُونَ, becomes تُؤْمِنُونَ, it means that iman is what? عَمَل. That's the قول he's taking. Then he says, وَقَالَ عِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ. نعم, have you read this?
وَقَالَ عِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ في قوله تعالى فوربك لنسألنهم أجمعين عما كانوا يعملون عن قول لا إله إلا الله لمثل هذا فليعمل العاملون.
This ayah, which is وتلك الجنة and paradise, جنة التي أورثتموها, in which you have inherited, in which we have given you, because the Prophet ﷺ told us that every single body has a place in Jannah and a place in Nar. Sahih. Even the disbeliever, he has a place in Jannah and in a place in the hellfire. He will be shown, this is the place in Jannah you could have gone to, you missed out. He now go to your place in the hellfire. The believer will be said, this was a place for you in the hellfire, you worked hard, you're not going to go there. You're now going to go to your place in Jannah. Everybody has a maq'adun fil Jannah wa maq'adun fil nar. So now it will be said to them, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ, and this is the Jannah, الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُهَا, which you've had inherited, you've taken from the place that you were not going to, which is the hellfire. Are you with me? Some scholars, they said urithumuha means you inherited it from a disbeliever who could have got that place. You inherited his position. Chris, who died upon disbelief. Ismail, you took his place. You inherited his place. That's what some scholars said. Are you with me? And also, the disbeliever, he inherits the place of the believer in the hellfire. So said to be him, Chris, you've now inherited the place of Ismail in Jahannam. Then Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he brought فَوَرَبِّكَ لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. فَوَرَبِّكَ, by your Lord, لَنَسْأَلَنَّهُمْ, we will ask them, and we will ask them, and we will ask them. Because that noon is noon al-Tawqid, so we have to keep repeating it like that, because it's emphasis. Allah said, we're going to ask them. Surely we are going to ask him. We're definitely going to ask them. عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ, that which they used to do. They used to do here means عَنْ قَوْلِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He said a group of learned scholars have actually said يَعْمَلُونَ here means لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, they used to do. So that shows that لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, which is iman, is an action. And that's what he's trying to use it رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And then the last point before the salah, لِمِثْلِ هَذَا فَلْيَعْمَلِ الْعَامِلُونَ, and the likes of this, let the ones who work for Jannah. So this shows what? That the believer enters Jannah because of hard effort and work he's put in, actions that he's come with. Which it will be said to him, لِمِثْلِ هَذَا, and like this place in Jannah, فَلْيَعْمَلِ الْعَامِلُونَ, let the ones who are working work for it. So no one enters Jannah by just believing something or just having something in their heart. There has to be actions which they come with.
In the same chapter, narrated by Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, what is the best deed? He replied, to believe in Allah and His Messenger. The questioner then asked, what is the next good deed in goodness? He replied, to participate in jihad in Allah's cause. The questioner again asked, what is the next in goodness? He replied, to perform hajj, mabrur, which is accepted by Allah, and is performed with the intention of seeking Allah's pleasure only and not to show off without committing any sin and in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
حدثنا أحمد بن يونس وموسى بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا
الإمام البخاري رحمه الله he said حدثنا أحمد بن يونس his name is أحمد بن عبد الله بن يونس but what Bukhari did was and not only him but other scholars do is نسب إلى جده he was attributed to his granddad so instead of saying أحمد بن عبد الله بن يونس they said أحمد بن يونس that's very common and that's done وموسى بن إسماعيل is a mutaba'a. It's a mutaba'a for who? Ahmed ibn Abdullah ibn Yunus. And this mutaba'a, you sammiha al-ulama, the scholars, they call it what? Mutaba'atun tamma. There's two types of mutaba'a. Mutaba'a tam, and there's a mutaba'a which is naqis. The mutaba'a which is tam is, if the two narrators, ishtaraka fi riwayat an shaykhil, they both narrate from one teacher together.
قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعد قال حدثنا ابن شهاب عن سعيد بن المسيب عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم
that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was asked the statement which أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل was asked
أي العمل أفضل
So here, we don't know who asked the question. So we don't know who the person is. So can we weaken the narration because of that? It doesn't harm us. Once it reaches Abu Huraira, إبهام الصحابي لا يضر. The ambiguity of a companion does not harm a narration. Because the companions, all of them are what? عدول, reliable. But out of benefit, we already know who the companion who asked is. When we brought other chains of narrations together, the companion who asked this question, his name is Abu Dhar al-Ghifari, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He's the one who asked this question. So fi ba'd turuq al-riwayat, some of the narrations that have come, it's become clear who is the one who's asking the question, and that it was Abu Dhar al-Ghifari. But even if we didn't know that it was Abu Dhar al-Ghifari, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, we would have still accepted it because it's what? Because it revolves around the companion, and the companions are all reliable. Na'am.
أي العمل أفضل؟
When the Prophet ﷺ was asked, أيُّ which? أيُّ means what? Which? العمل here, it's actually مفرد, لكن it's intended actions. It means الأعمال التي يتقرب بها إلى الله. Which actions gets us closer to Allah تبارك وتعالى? That's the best. So the Prophet specifically being asked, which action? In which, if we do, it will get us closest to Allah. Which of the best? Which is the best action for us to do? And remember, the question here is asking what? Action. He's asking what? Which action is the best? And Imam al-Bukhari, we chapter in his Sahih here right now, Babu man qala inna al-imana huwa al-amalu. Look what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said. So look at the word ayyul amali afdal, and look at the response that the Prophet gives.
فقال إيمان بالله ورسوله.
So what was the Prophet's respond? Believing in Allah and the Messenger. The question was asked, which is the best action? And the Prophet said, believing in Allah and his Messenger. So believing in Allah and his Messenger is a action. And this is a refutation again on the Murji'a who take the action out of مسمى الإيمان. They take the action out of the real meaning of what Iman is. That's the refutation on them. Are you with me, brothers? نعم.
قيل ثم ماذا؟ قال الجهاد في سبيل الله.
Again, the Prophet. Again, this is another evidence to show you a refutation of the Murji'ah. When the Prophet was asked which is the best action, he responded with al-imanu billah. Then he mentioned al-jihadu fi sabilillah in the context of what? Believing in Allah. To show you again that jihad fi sabilillah and al-iman, both of them are actions because they've been mentioned in the same context. Na'am. Because everyone knows jihad is an action, true or false. So then if it's been mentioned in the same context, that it's also the same as it. Na'am.
قيل ثم ماذا؟ قال حج مبرور.
And then the Prophet was asked after that. Then he said a hajj which is accepted. Hajj mabrur means la ithma fihi wa la riya. There's no sin in it and there's no showing off in it. Some of the scholars, they say no, it means hajjun maqbool, a hajj that's accepted. And you know there's a difference between hajjun sahih and hajjun maqbool. It's different. A hajj which is correct doesn't necessarily mean it's accepted. Sahih? Naam. Benefits that we take from this hadith is number one. The first thing this hadith shows us, that a person can get closer to Allah, the greatest thing is what? Imanu billahi, to believe in Allah and to believe in the Messenger. To believe in Allah and to believe in the Messenger, it's from the greatest actions that get you closer to Allah. Number two, manzilatul jihad fi sabilillah, the status of fighting for the cause of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and the station of al-hajj al-mabrur, how they've become so distinctly chosen from all the righteous actions that a person can do. It shows you how high these actions are. Number three, this hadith also shows you the striving of the companions in asking beneficial knowledge. They didn't ask, Ya Rasulullah, you know how people ask you when they get question and answer session. Instead of asking you beneficial knowledge, they choose not to ask those questions. The Sahabas asked, Ayyul amali afdal, what's the best action? And the reason why they asked this is because they wanted to implement it in their lives. So what we need to understand is asking a good question is actually a station or a progress that you can reach. A good question is actually the first step of actually coming with righteous actions. Number four, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to be asked this same question so many times from different companions, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would answer with different questions, answers. When he was asked before, what did he say? Ayyul amali afdal, what did he say? Man salima al-muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadi. And again he got asked, Ayyul amali afdal, what did he respond? Yeah? Huh? Tut'imu al-ta'am wa taqra'u al-salam ala man araftu wa ala man lan ta'arif. Sah? Same question. Every time it was different. The reason why the Prophet ﷺ had changed between that is what? To show you that mura'at muqtata al-mukhatab. Look at the person you're addressing. As the scholars, they say, طُعْمُ الْكِبَارِ سُمُّ الصِّغَارِ. Burger is good for you. You might like a burger. But a newborn baby, that's not a good meal for it. He might die from it. So whatever good for you doesn't necessarily mean it's good for everybody. Okay? Just because you feel like it's good for you doesn't mean that it's good for everybody. So you need to watch that and observe that. Number five, what we benefit from it is how to reconcile between the statement of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي نُورِثُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. This ayah, what does it tell us? That you've inherited Jannah with what? What's the reason why they inherited Jannah? Because of actions they've done, right? But then where do we take the hadith of the Prophet? لَنْ يَدْخُلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِعَمَلِهِ. One of you is not going to enter Jannah because of his actions. So how do we reconcile between this ayah and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying that one of you will not enter Jannah with actions that he has come with. And then the ayah here is saying, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. You've inherited Jannah and you've gained this position in Jannah because of actions that you have done. Okay. The scholars, they mentioned, and I'm going to go over it very fast and not spend too much time because I was told 15 minutes and I'm going to stick by my words, inshallah ta'ala, is the ayah, وَتِلْ, and this is the importance of grammar, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. This ba is called ba'u sababiyya. This called is what? Ba'u sababiyya. As for the ba inside, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِعَمَلِهِ. This ba is not ba'u sababiyya. It's known as ba'u al-iwad or ba'u al-muqabala. Ba'u al-iwad or ba'u al-muqabala. So if since the ba's are two different ba's, then the meaning changes. Each one takes a different meaning. Okay, and Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah is the one who brought this to our attention in his kitab Zadul Mi'ad fi Hadi Khayr al-Ibad. The other benefit that we take from this is the other benefit that we take from here is Okay, sorry. There's three responses that the scholars gave. So one response I gave, which is that the ba's are two different. One ba' is ba' sababiyya, and the other ba' is called ba' al-iwad wal-muqabala. The second response that the scholars reconciled between the ayah and the hadith is that what's been negated in the hadith of the Prophet that says, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِعَمَلِي, that one of you will not enter Jannah because of his action, it means al-amal al-mujarrad, just the mere actions, okay? An action, just a mere action. No one enters Jannah because of the mere action. Rather, what makes you go to Jannah is with Allah's acceptance, right? So the hadith is negating that you're not entering Jannah because of the actions alone. So, whereas the ayah is saying that you're entering Jannah with the action that Allah has accepted from you. Also, the third explanation that the scholars give, which is that the person enters Jannah first of all, ibtida'an, first of all, to enter Jannah, the person enters Jannah because of Allah's mercy. But then the action helps you to gain within Jannah stations. So what brought you into Jannah in the first place is Allah's mercy. And then once you got into Jannah, what made you grow inside Jannah is actions. And they use the evidence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, iqra, read, war, taqi, and go up, warattil, and recite the Quran. فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَتَكَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ آيَةٍ تَقْرَأُهَا, because your final station is going to be the last verse which you read. So they said that the way to reconcile between it is that the hadith that say, لَا يَنْدْخُلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِعَمَلِهِ, is saying to you, in order to enter Jannah in the first place, Allah's mercy is going to bring you to Jannah. No action can bring you to Jannah. And the ayah which is saying, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ, is not talking about coming into Jannah. It's talking about growing and going levels in Jannah. And that's how they reconciled. And those are the three aqwal. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions each and every one of them, رَحِمَهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً. And I also think Ibn Hajar, رَحِمَهُ he mentions it. My beloved brothers and sisters, I'm going to conclude there, inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong, mistake, error, or shortcoming is from me and shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. I also want to thank the masjid and the management of the masjid allowing me to explain the book, having good thoughts of me, and allowing me to come to help share my small little knowledge. I also thank the brothers who were reading it, Brother Abu Bakr and Brother Imran, for also reading the hadith in Arabic and English. Next time, inshallah ta'ala, you guys have an idea of how we should be doing things, inshallah. So next time when we come, we should start maybe from Fajr and maybe take it up to Isha or something, so we can finish the book, inshallah ta'ala. So we're going to conclude there.